Exploring our electric skies is one of the great adventures of modern science. This is a journey into the heart of thunderstorms, to scientific frontiers. And into a world no human eye has ever seen.
It's coming, 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 coming. Coming, coming, coming. Whoa!
Scientists hunting flashes of lightning need to be weatherproof and super patient. They spend hours in their cars getting to the middle of nowhere, driven by a vague hope to be in the perfect place at the perfect time for the perfect flash. Too bad that it rarely works out. They dream of powerful thunderstorms with flashes galore. They need expensive technical gear and lots of luck. In those rare moments when the force is with them, they are rewarded with stunning images that help us understand the world we live in. Extreme slow motion splits up a flash of lightning that lasts just a brief moment into hundreds of fleeting fractions. The era of modern lightning research began about four decades ago.
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3.
In 1969, lightning research received a powerful impulse from Apollo 12, the second mission to walk on the moon. During liftoff, Florida was shaken by thunderstorms. 36 seconds into the flight, two bolts of lightning knocked out the spacecraft's electronic system, nearly spelling disaster.
I don't know what happened here. We had everything in the world drop out. I'm not sure if you get hit by lightning.
After a disaster was closely avoided by presence of mind, huge budgets were suddenly available for lightning research. This man was among the experts who made good use of the financial windfall. Martin Yuman, a pioneer of international lightning science. This is his realm, a forest clearing in the heart of Florida. For decades, he and his team have lured flashes from the clouds and analyzed them in great detail. Florida has one of the globe's highest incidences of thunderstorms, due in part to sea breezes from two coasts, high humidity, and a sun-heated land surface. Martin Heumann and his team have perfected a technique first used in the 60s. Sending tiny rockets trailing wires into clouds, they can trigger flashes of lightning. One end of the wire remains connected to the ground, so the wire acts as a lightning rod, offering an easy path for the electric charge of the cloud.
Well, at the beginning, we had so many problems. We had so many things to overcome with the way the spools that we have the wire on, the way the spools would unwind. They wouldn't unwind properly. The rockets, choosing which rocket to actually use, how fast you want it to go. These are all problems that have to be solved when you trigger lightning. And sometimes that works easily, sometimes it doesn't.
For years, Christopher Biaggi has been part of the team launching rockets from this base. He is thoroughly familiar with the region's weather. When a storm approaches, he gets as excited as on his first day on the job.
Chris, do you copy?
Yes, I do.
Okay, we're starting to have things build down here. I think we should get ready.
Stand by. Are you ready?
Yeah, just double checking the cameras here. One second. All right, we're ready to go.
Roger that. We're going to be shooting 2-4. The fields are beginning to drop. It looks like they're down around 3.5-4 kV. We're passing through 5 kV, 5.5 kV. Stand by. I'm going to go ahead and arm 2-4. So stand by for a countdown.
-6, stand by for a countdown.
3, 2, 1, fire.
The rocket is launched as soon as the electric field in the air reaches a defined level. The wire that connects the rocket with the ground causes the flash to hit the launcher. The two high-speed cameras show that the flash consists of several phases. A photograph that seems almost magical gives an impression of how spectacular this natural phenomenon really is.
And so this is a still picture of that whole event. The reason it's looking like it is because the wind blows this to one side as the lightning takes place. So there's actually maybe a tenth of a second between these, but during that tenth of a second, the wind is blowing enough so that it separates these up. And the beautiful thing about it to me was that there's so many pieces of this that some we've never seen before, some we've never seen like this, but this has so many sections to it that are just fascinating to me. If you were to look at this taken out of context, it would be very difficult to believe this is lightning. And I think that's what I find so exciting, is that there are too many times when we see pictures of lightning that seem very bland and boring, but then there are times like this when you need to see it at so many scales to understand what's really going on. And this is one of those pictures to me that just has all of that in it. And I would like to take it piece by piece and just figure out what's happening. That's really what we're here for.
The more you know about lightning flashes, the more diverse they seem. How does a flash find its target? What makes the flashes branch out? Even basic questions are still being discussed. What we do know for certain is this. A storm cloud is an inferno of wind, rain, and ice. Rising warm air carries up droplets of water that collide with ice particles at a great altitude and at a speed of around 180 kilometers per hour. These collisions produce electrical charges. Most storm clouds build up a sequence of layers of positive and negative space charges. Their composition determines where lightning initiates and how it develops. A physical mechanism of lightning initiation is still not fully understood. One of many speculative theories even suggested that lightning is started by cosmic ray showers. The charged particles racing through the air are being slowed down by air molecules. But suddenly, powered by cosmic rays, they accelerate to almost the speed of light, which triggers the actual flash. But the struggle to find a physically sound explanation of lightning initiation mechanism is far from over. The majority of flashes develop inside the clouds, only a fraction between clouds and land surface. Under certain conditions, a flash can leave a cloud sideways and strike many kilometers away. Literally, out of the blue. The rapid improvement of video cameras has brought a great bonus to lightning research. Tom Warner is a meteorologist and lightning expert.
Well, this is a van that has a number of different cameras that allow me to film lightning and analyze its optical properties. It's got an array of different high-speed and digital still and HD cameras. And for example, this is a high-speed camera, and this one allows me to film at 2,000 images per second. And I've installed the bubble, actually, on the van that allows me to see at different angles as I move the camera around as the storm moves by. And as far as the cameras inside, they also project onto monitors and have computers that actually control the cameras themselves. I'll start off by talking about the high-speed cameras. These are the heart of the system, and this camera right here is one of the fastest cameras made. I typically film lightning at 54,000 images per second, and this camera is a bit slower. I usually film at 7,200 images per second with this one, with a little wider field of view. And at the heart of the system is this trigger. I'm out watching for the lightning flash, and when I see one that I'm interested in, I'll hit the trigger. It saves all the information onto the hard drives, and then I can download it and analyze it.
Tom Warner's hunting grounds are around Rapid City, between the Great Plains and the Black Hills. The dry climate at this high elevation means better visibility and high clouds, so lightning is easier to see for greater distances.
When I saw this place first time, when I saw this open sky, no obstacles, hills, I immediately realized this is a dream for a scientist who wants to study lightning. And especially because you have seven towers here. So this is an absolutely unique possibility to do first-class research at this place.
Vlad Mazur works for the U.S. National Severe Storms Laboratory and advises Tom on his doctoral thesis. The towers are objects of their study, not because they attract lightning flashes, but because they send them out.
These towers behind me are struck by lightning several times during thunderstorm season. But if we don't have towers on this hill, we can wait for 8 or 10 years before natural lightning will strike this area. So what it means that probability of lightning strikes to tall structures like these TV towers are hundreds times higher than probability of lightning strike in a similar area but without.
The storms typically develop over the Black Hills during the afternoon and move on to the plains in the evening. Tom is after the perfect flash. That is, upward flashes that are triggered by the towers. Each photo and video sequence helps to unveil the secret.
I never get tired of watching lightning. To me, it's probably one of the most powerful things that nature can display. To be able to see that bright light, just the thunder that comes after it, is just remarkable. It's just an awesome show of what nature can do. And I never get bored watching it. Any chance I can to watch lightning, I'm out there watching it. And it truly is an amazing thing to behold.
The speed of a flash of lightning is unimaginable. Around 500 million kilometers per hour. Details cannot be seen with the naked eye.
A typical lightning strike is probably about a half a second, but they can vary to very short, to just a couple of milliseconds, to maybe almost a second. But it depends if there's multiple strokes. You know, a lightning flash encompasses all the flash, including the multiple strokes that you might get. And if it doesn't have a lot of strokes, individual strokes, then it's just shorter. If it has a bunch of strokes, it could be a longer flash, you know, sometimes even up to a second.
What happens within a single second? First, let's see a basketball and a lightning researcher in real time, recorded at 25 frames per second. Now the same at 100 frames per second. Each second, in reality, is stretched over 4 seconds in the film. now 10 times slower. If the action is shot at 1,000 frames per second, 1 second in reality is 40 seconds in the film. One second is the average duration of a flash, but we can sit back and take 40 seconds to watch. To understand the slow motion effect even better, let's compare it to a real-time flash, as we see it naturally. Now the same flash, recorded with 1,000 frames per second. The flag seems to freeze. The flash is broken down into several phases. Tom Warner has gone even further, stretching a single real-time second to 6 minutes. What you'll see now even gets the pros excited.
Here's a positive ground flash, and this was filmed at 11,000 images per second. And it starts off with some in-cloud brightening, which are events that we really can't see because they're obscured by the cloud. The flash continues for quite a long time. This flash takes about a third of a second to develop, which actually is a long time in terms of the high-speed playback.
One third of a second, that's the twinkling of an eye. In Tom's video, it stretched out to 2 minutes.
As it continues down, we can see it's continuing to develop.
Continuing to develop
downward as the flash goes on, and once it gets closer to the ground, it'll start accelerating.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. You can see it, how it goes slowly down. And now you have recoils.
Never before has it been possible to observe the total duration of a flash in such detail.
It was some interaction within the cloud.
Mm-hmm. Now we're getting close to the point.
It's beautiful. Oh, such a case.
And we'll see the...
Oh. Look, it's coming.
There we go. Now it's starting to brighten as it accelerates.
Yeah, it's coming. Boom! You have a return stroke now.
Yeah. So now we get the return stroke.
Beautiful.
And even after the return stroke, we get all kinds of strobing events continuing on afterwards, as well as a variation in the brightness of the main channel that formed the return stroke. And the whole time we're looking at this bright channel, there's current flowing, and this is what brings the current to the ground, could cause heating and cause damage to...
And fire, to
whatever it's connected to.
Wonderful case. Ooh!
And this one will just keep going for a long time. Especially with these types of flashes, you can get a very long continuing current where the channel stays connected for a long period of time. And again, that means more charge transfer, more heating, more damage to those items that it's connected to.
Okay, and slowly subsiding now.
Yeah.
Wonderful case. Just perfect example, absolutely perfect.
If tall structures are involved, the action can be reversed. The flash that strikes the tower does not come from the cloud, but it originates on the top of the structure and goes up. This development of the upward lightning is shown in the following unique camera take. The real-time duration is barely 1 second. The lightning flash does not seek out the tower. The tower sends out the flash. To start, lightning needs some triggering conditions or a nucleus that creates these conditions in a region of a strong electric field. Although this process is still not fully understood, it became obvious that lightning flashes can be triggered by towering structures on the ground or by airplanes flying through thunderstorms. The danger is limited. The electronic systems that control modern aircrafts have double and triple safeguards against electrical surges. Researchers found that to prevent flashes striking a plane, it is better to fly right through a storm, where existing triggering conditions produce frequent lightning flashes, rather than to fly along the outskirts of the active storm and be the only trigger around. Lightning starts from two opposite extremities of the plane, with the plane becoming a part of the lightning channel. This unique amateur video shows how we perceive the process.
Whoa!
The human eye only sees a single brief shine, but detailed images show that in fact there was one main flash and two consequent flashes. The airliner appears unscathed. Only in exceptional situations does lightning pose a danger to aircraft. This is also the case with the mysterious ball lightning. Inside airplanes and along their skin, ball lightning has been observed. There have only been 38 documented cases in six decades. This is what it might look like. Ball lightning is a hitherto unexplained phenomenon, and there are few credible eyewitnesses. However, there have been similar reports over three centuries. This is Cristiano Bastos. As a member of a lightning research team, he's working on his doctoral thesis. The tune he wrote is titled Ball Lightning. And these are his colleagues. Cherson Paiva, who has already completed his thesis on ball lightning, and Antonia Pavan, their professor. Their experiments and results have drawn broad attention. Their lab is in Recife, Brazil, at the University of Pernambuco. What is ball lightning? How does it come about? Across the world, scientists are looking for answers. Paiva and Pavan tested an existing theory which says that ball lightning is created when a normal flash hits the ground and quartz sand is vaporized. The vapor glows in the air. Since quartz sand consists of silicon, the researchers used silicon wafers to imitate the ground. The flash is imitated with an electric welder. The wafers are hit by a 200 ampere current. At first, this results in a spray of sparks familiar from welding. But the sparks disappear after just 1 second. What remains are luminous spheres that last up to 8 seconds and are hot enough to burn one's fingers. Whether these spheres are comparable to those observed in nature, however, is uncertain. There are dozens of theories. Some believe that lightning balls are tiny black holes or consist of antimatter. The Brazilians suspect that the tiny luminous spheres can not only be produced from silicon, but also from other metals, if much greater amounts of energy are used. So much energy that small atom clusters will be vaporized. Natural lightning balls are bigger, about the size of a grapefruit, but other properties are astoundingly similar to the experimental spheres.
Herzlich willkommen beim Wetter. Heute der heißeste Tag des Jahres und die Hot.
Today the risk of being struck by lightning can be calculated better than ever before. In many countries, the weather report gets its facts from a nationwide lightning monitoring network that locates flashes with a precision of a few hundred meters.
Und unser Blitzortungssystem Aldis hat heute tausende Blitzentladungen registriert, zwei große.
The TV cameras show data from sensors that pick up the electromagnetic signals from each flash. On the monitor, they can be seen as orange and red marks, showing the trail of a storm.
Über das Müll- und über das Waldviertel gezogen, hat Gott sei Dank hier noch keine.
There are 130 sensors across Europe. The data are distributed to the media, to meteorological stations, insurance companies and energy providers. A heavy storm front creates a wake of colored spots, each symbolizing a single flash of lightning which has been recorded and saved at the very moment of its event. It is difficult to give exact figures of damages caused by lightning. One survey has estimated costs exceeding $5 billion per year in the US alone. The fear of lightning is as old as the question of how to protect oneself outdoors. Martin Heumann is one of the world's leading experts on lightning. What does he think of the familiar rules?
Well, I think they're pretty good. If you can hear loud thunder, or if you can count the time between the thunder and the lightning, and it's less than 30 seconds or so, the lightning is closer than 5 miles or so, it's time to take cover.
The chances of being struck by lightning are really tiny, except if someone really asks for it. Asking for it would mean, for instance, to spend a summer afternoon in an open area, such as a golf course. Your chances rise when you ignore dark storm clouds and thunder, assuming that the storm is still far away.
Unfortunately, a lot of the people, or a number of the people that get struck by the first or second lightning in a storm. So they don't really have any warning except to look at a warning from thunder, except to look and see that there is a dark cloud overhead. So one needs to even be more proactive than waiting for thunder. Yeah, where you shouldn't be if there's a storm is out walking on the beach or out in a small boat.
People are running because it's gonna be, it's sprinkling now.
Yeah,
but it's a long ways offshore. It's sprinkling.
If you're way out in the woods or on a kayaking trip or something like that, you should go in a group of similar sized trees and just wait out the storm. Not getting under a big tree for sure, because that's more likely to get struck. And if you can stay about 3 or 4 meters away from any tree trunk, it's even safer. Well, what I do is I go and try to find an automobile to get into, because rarely are you far enough away from civilization that you can't find a sizable building or a car.
Metal jewelry or mobile phones make no difference. Flashes are indifferent to them.
Ja, na, das ist jetzt ein ziemlich blöder Zeitpunkt.
What counts is being the highest point in the landscape. When struck by lightning, the chances of survival depend on the strength of the flash, the path it takes through the body, and the time that passes before medical help arrives. And what about ball lightning?
If you see ball lightning, the better is go out from that region. I do not recommend to stay near a ball lightning, of course.
Lightning not only affects humans, but the entire planet. The biosphere is caught between two electrically charged units, the atmosphere and the ground, a system that can be connected to measuring instruments.
This antenna we have here is a VLF antenna for very low frequency. It detects the pulses emitted by lightning up to a few thousand kilometers from the station. This station here in Tel Aviv is one of 30 stations around the globe which continuously are monitoring lightning activity somewhere on the planet. And by taking the exact timing that every pulse comes into the station, we look at the difference in the time of arrival at all the different stations, and by that we can actually get the location within 10 kilometers anywhere on the planet.
Practically no flash escapes documentation. Flashes produce electromagnetic waves around the globe, humming a monotonous tune. Listening to it informs us about the weather.
We found that there's a very good correlation between thunderstorm activity over Central Africa and the initiation of hurricanes in the Atlantic Ocean maybe 2 weeks later.
Two-thirds of all Atlantic hurricanes are preceded by an increased number of thunderstorms in eastern and central Africa. Storms in Africa get in the way of the trade winds, affecting them like huge rocks in a river. They create eddies and waves. The bigger a rock or the stronger a storm, the greater the turbulence it causes. These turbulences cause low pressure areas. Every other low pressure area causes tropical storms over the Atlantic. For US weather warning services, it's worth watching the weather in Africa. Lightning is an important element in a sensitive global climate system. The more we find out about lightning, the clearer this becomes. This lonely antenna in the Negev Desert is also part of a global monitoring network, registering the signals emitted by lightning. The further away from storms they are, the better.
I compare it to listening to an orchestra. When you're listening to an orchestra, to hear the music, you have to be far away from the orchestra, not sitting next to the drummer. If you're sitting right next to the drummer, which is the thunderstorms, you don't hear the global music. And so to hear the global sounds of lightning, you have to be far away from lightning in very quiet regions in the desert.
Or in space. Based on satellite data, NASA created a world map of lightning which shows the distribution of flashes across the year. The red and yellow areas mark concentrations of storms. Lightning occurs most frequently in the tropics and rarely near the poles. In the north and in the south, thunderstorms occur mostly in the summer. Along the equator, there are thunderstorms all year round. Globally, at any given time, about 2,000 thunderstorms are active, emitting up to 100 flashes per second. Satellite data have confirmed an old wisdom. There are few thunderstorms over the oceans.
We always knew that there was more lightning over land than over the ocean. When we saw those patterns, it was just so dramatic, the differencing and how sharply the lightning dropped off as soon as you got off the coastline and started going over the water. And it really concluded very clearly that most lightning is caused by heating of the earth and producing air mass thunderstorms, which results in the lightning.
Steve Kummer and his team are just beginning the night shift at the field station of Duke University, North Carolina. Their mission is not hunting mosquitoes, but so-called sprites, mysterious flashes that are discharged way above the storms at a height of 80 kilometers. Sprites are the hottest topic in international lightning research.
Who do you want sitting down?
To photograph and film sprites, the scientists have to be night active. They hope for clear skies and distant thunderstorms, and that the mosquito spray won't let them down. Sprites are practically invisible to the naked eye. To document them, highly sensitive cameras are needed. A rule of thumb is, if a camera can see stars, it can also see sprites. The lenses are aimed at a section of the sky above an area which is 200 to 400 kilometers away from the camp, where thunderstorms are expected after nightfall. With some luck, sprites will appear above the storms. Fascinating as sprites may be, most of the takes are rather colorless. A brief flicker, that's all. But since this is completely new territory, each image counts. The cameras are triggered by a sensor that registers even the slightest changes of brightness. The sensors are controlled by a computer program of the type used by UFO watchers.
My understanding is that this software was really made for amateurs who were interested in setting up cameras in their backyards and capturing interesting unexplained phenomena. But it turns out that the software is really well written and very versatile, and it turns out to be an ideal tool for capturing sprites and related events.
Right now it's 10 degrees.
A match demonstrates the sensitivity of these cameras. To a normal TV camera, it looks like this. The cameras used by the scientists turn the match into a bright torch. Catching sprites requires patience. Sometimes it takes days until a suitable thunderstorm passes by.
So we're at lightning?
Finally, a signal. The software has detected something and triggered the cameras.
Not yet.
False alarm. Just a bat.
Is that a bat? Is that a bat?
That's more.
Most of the captured images are planes, bats, insects, and falling stars. Mostly falling stars. There are still other ghostly flashes that have been recorded over the years. Gigantic fountains of light, for instance, called blue jets. They also occur above thunderstorms at heights of up to 50 kilometers. No one knows how they're produced. Elves are disc-shaped lit areas at a height of about 100 kilometers and with a diameter of some 400 kilometers. They are probably produced by the electromagnetic impulses of normal storm flashes. Only a few quality images of sprites exist, They look like bright vines branching out from a sphere of light. It's unknown what they signify.
As we've studied these things for the last 10 to 15 years, I think we're all starting to realize that these are, sprites in particular, are pretty common. I would say that the odds are pretty good that you will see one or two sprites from almost every storm that's big enough.
After years of research, it is clear that all these wonderful light phenomena, sprites, blue jets, and elves, have one thing in common. They can occur anywhere around the globe, but only in connection with thunderstorms. To a lightning researcher, the sky is full of mysteries. Once you begin watching these natural spectacles, you are hooked. Sooner or later, every flash hunter ends up in Darwin, northern Australia. Darwin prides itself on being the lightning capital of the world. Half the time, the air is saturated with moisture, and it's steaming hot.
I think I might have got that. Have a look. I might have got one.
For a couple of months, there is hardly a day without a thunderstorm out here, and hardly a day without Mike O'Neill. He is a passionate storm chaser, wielding his camera every free minute, afternoons, evenings, and at midnight.
Now, the storms are about between 40 and 50,000 feet high when they get to their peak. The storm behind, it's moving to the northeast, probably on the outskirts of Darwin, probably won't reach Darwin. You can see the rain shaft in the centre there, so it's a healthy storm. New clouds forming around this same storm and behind us, so any outflow that comes out from the storm, it'll create new convection, which will in turn create new storms. So this area is fairly much a hotspot for good storms, large storms.
When the dry season gives way to the rainy season, the land around Darwin is a parading ground of storm clouds. Their wild beauty is literally electrifying.
I think after I took my first lightning strike, it was something that just blew me away. I couldn't believe that you could have such beauty out of a storm and yet be so dangerous. What was first just an interest became an obsession that I just have to get that perfect shot. I suppose it'll never happen because every lightning strike that you do photograph is a one-off. You'll never get the same image again, ever. For me, I'd spend my last $2 in petrol to go chase a storm if I can get a lightning strike out of it.